everybody. So my name is Brooke Martin. Currently, I'm a student at Concordia University, Wisconsin. It's in Wisconsin. I know we're in California. It's kind of weird. My program is hybrid. So over this last summer, I went back to the campus and I did some classes there. But most of my courses are online, which is why I can be here today with you guys. Cool?
Cool.
Yay.
Cool.
Nice.
So, I'm just going to say, as a reinforcer, I have Starburst. So I'm going to open up open discussion, really, throughout this presentation. So if at any time you have questions or you want to discuss something, we'll stop the presentation and we'll open up the floor, okay? Sound good? Any questions so far? All right. Next slide. So what is empathy? So just the standard Google definition gives us a definition of the ability to understand and share the feelings of another. Kirvin.
Why is empathy, why is it like TH and the E is backwards? And
so in the dictionaries, they do that so you can tell how to pronounce a word.
Awesome. Ooh, thank you for the Star Wars.
You're
welcome. It was in pink.
Yeah. You can go ahead and play the brief video.
So what is empathy, and why is it very different than sympathy? Empathy fuels connection. Sympathy drives disconnection. Empathy, it's very interesting. Teresa Wiseman is a nursing scholar who studied professions, very diverse professions, where empathy is relevant, and came up with four qualities of empathy. Perspective taking, the ability to take the perspective of another person or recognize their perspective as their truth. Staying out of judgment, not easy when you enjoy it as much as most of us do. Recognizing emotion in other people and then communicating that. Empathy is feeling with people. And to me, I always think of empathy as this kind of sacred space when someone's kind of in a deep hole and they shout out from the bottom and they say, I'm stuck, it's dark, I'm overwhelmed. And then we look and we say, hey, calm down. I know what it's like down here, and you're not alone. Sympathy is, woo! It's bad, uh-huh? No. You want a sandwich? Empathy is a choice, and it's a vulnerable choice, because in order to connect with you, I have to connect with something in myself that knows that feeling. Rarely, if ever, does an empathic response begin with that. And we do it all the time. Because you know what? Someone just shared something with us that's incredibly painful, and we're trying to silver lining it. I don't think that's a verb, but I'm using it as one. We're trying to put the silver lining around it. So, I had a miscarriage. At least you know you can get pregnant. I think my marriage is falling apart. At least you have a marriage. John's getting kicked out of school. At least Sarah is an A student. But one of the things we do sometimes in the face of very difficult conversations is we try to make things better. If I share something with you that's very difficult, I'd rather you say, I don't even know what to say right now, I'm just so glad you told me. Because the truth is, rarely can a response make something better. What makes something better is connection.
So does anyone have any thoughts about this video? Or using, you know, at least this about the situation?
I liked it because it was animated.
You liked it because it was animated.
Yeah, it was pretty cool. Thank you for the Starburst.
You're welcome, Mariah.
I like that the other characters kind of understood what was going on.
Right, so you had the one character who was kind of acting insensitive toward the individual that was having a hard time, right?
Yeah.
Saying, well, at least you have this other thing going on, but does that really help them feel like they're being understood?
No.
No. Right? Okay. Ready? I'm gonna toss it.
snatched.
Nice snag. Natasha.
It just kind of morally reminds me that it's important to try to put yourself in other people's shoes. Mm-hmm. I guess because if you don't, then you're going to obviously not understand it as much. I mean, there's situations every day where I don't understand them. I don't go through them, but I try to talk to that person and see how it feels and what, you know, and support them through it, not just be, it's whatever, you know.
Right, and I think that that's an important consideration, especially in this tight-knit community that we have here, right? We have people here that are going through stuff every day.
Well, clearly, if someone comes up to you to talk to you, they want to talk to you because they trust you. Let's see.
I think empathy is important, like, because if you have empathy, like, it just makes, like, a person, like, feel like they can talk more, because, like, you're being nice to them, and you're like, oh, I feel you, like,
yeah. And we're going to get a little bit more into that in a bit, okay? Thanks. Can you click the slide? There we go.
Step up your game, Jake.
So here's a quote from one of my favorite authors, Walt Whitman. And he says, I do not ask the wounded person how he feels. I myself become the wounded person. So he's literally putting himself in someone else's shoes to get the perspective of that individual, right? To really relate deeply, to feel that empathy, kindness, and
that's really strong.
Person. Exactly. Perfect.
I feel like that's a good quote because, like, you, like, sometimes having been through the same thing as that person.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
I don't really want one anymore, but
you can share with that. Well, so that brings up a good point, though, Kirvin. So you said that you may have not encountered the same thing as someone else, right? So how can we practice empathy if we haven't experienced something that someone else has?
Talk to them.
How?
I feel like you could try to talk to them and relate the feelings in different ways. Does that make sense? You know, like if a different situation happened and you had all those same feelings as that person, understand that and try to understand what they're saying more.
No, that makes total sense.
Sorry, my computer went blank.
Oh, you did.
Yeah, so you may not understand their exact situation, but you might still understand those feelings that are associated. Like, you might be angry, or the other individual might be angry about one thing that you haven't experienced before, but you know what anger feels like, mm-hmm. and you know what it feels like to be angry, right? Next slide. So, what is your definition of empathy? And why do you think it is important to practice being empathic? Anybody? Natasha?
I've always just explained empathy as putting yourself in someone else's shoes. Mm-hmm. Kind of dummies it down a little bit, but that's always the way I've looked at it.
Right.
I used to get empathy and sympathy confused, so that's why I just gave them both short definitions.
Yeah, that's one of the reasons why I included that first video. Is because oftentimes those two terms are confused.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you feel like the video did help you in solidifying?
Yeah, because I've always gotten them mixed up, and I just kind of gave them both short scenarios to remember it. Mm-hmm. So it would be really helpful for someone that doesn't really, because I used to mix them up all the time.
Awesome. I'm glad that brought some clarity.
You heard that hit my stomach.
Any other thoughts? Any other definitions or thoughts that people have about empathy?
How do we practice it?
How do we practice empathy? I'd like to hear from you guys. How do you all practice empathy?
They have gelatin in them.
I practice it as trying to get together with everybody I ever knew. Trying to have a good time. Trying to focus on what's going on now. What's going on.
Awesome, I like that. So keeping things more in the present. Yeah.
I'm allergic to them.
Well,
Roland, can do you have them, any thoughts? But if I eat too much, I'll get sick.
No? Alicia?
That's why I only ate like two out of those four.
Okay.
So we had.
Can move to the next one. All right. And here's another quote that I have from Marcus Aurelius, who was actually a Roman emperor and a philosopher. Whenever you are about to find fault with someone, ask yourself the following question. What fault of mine most nearly resembles the one I am about to criticize? Does this evoke any thoughts or feelings from anyone, this quote? So this doesn't always, empathy doesn't always have to do with, you know, feeling for someone, okay? It can have something to do with recognizing when someone is feeling emotion and say, you need to give them space. Feeling that empathy to know what their needs might be in a certain situation. And also, you know, whether or not you've been in the same boat before too. Like you might be really angry about something. Should we criticize someone else for being angry? No, but we should allow them the space to feel that anger and maybe help them through to the other side, right?
Oh, I guess I just don't understand the message this quote is trying to say.
What do you think it means?
I don't really know. That's why I don't understand the message it's trying to send.
So, basically it's about criticism and judgment.
Okay.
So practicing empathy as a way to step away from criticizing or judging another person
okay.
for their experience.
It was just the way it was worded that confused me.
Right. Okay. But does that make more sense?
Yeah. That's
so, has anyone ever, you know, felt maybe a little judgy about someone else's situation?
Yeah, I can see that. Like, now that you've explained it more, I can
I have, but to an extent.
Okay, what's that extent?
Like, I've been in the system for 4 years. I mean, home situations always affect the person as who they are, so I won't judge things that their family does or, like, whatever.
Yeah.
But I guess sometimes I judge the ridiculousness of, like, reactions or even, I mean, because I get pretty ridiculous sometimes. But it just, I guess I judge reactions sometimes, and mm-hmm. That's still not okay,
right.
And it's something I have to work on, but I do that.
Right, and that's hard sometimes, right?
Yeah.
When someone else is being super reactive and they might be in your face about something, you know, we might need to practice empathy in that moment and say, hey, I see where you're coming from, and I understand you're having a hard time right now, and I'm not going to react to that, basically, but I'm here to empathize with you and help you through the situation if I can. Natasha.
Thank you.
Did you have your hand up in the back?
Yeah. This quote kind of resembles to me, like, rejection. Is that what you're kind of talking about?
Yeah.
Like, if, let's say you have your own problem, like weight loss, or whatever, but you're making fun of someone else.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. So we all have our own struggles, like if someone is overweight, and you might be struggling with that too. Oh my goodness. I forgot what I was going to say. That was a little distracting. That's all right. So, can we kind of settle on this quote? And if you have any questions about anything in the presentation at the end, feel free to come up to me and we can talk through that, okay? So, here are just some general facets of empathy. So, empathy is sensing what others are feeling and seeking other perspectives. It's the ability to recognize another's emotional state. And the more skillful you are at discerning, so picking apart those feelings behind other signals, the better threshold of signals that you are sending. Okay? I feel like that one's really important. Empathy involves listening carefully, picking up on what people are truly saying, and responding accordingly. And empathy can be described as listening for emotion, which in turn makes people feel like they're understood. So does all of these points make sense to everybody? Yeah? Okay, does anyone have any questions or want to expand on anything? We're good? All right. So I included this little infographic because I feel like it's really good about breaking empathy down into a visual. So four elements are the ability to see someone else's world, come from a place of non-judgment, and appreciate the individual as human beings, understand their feelings, and then also have the ability to communicate that you understand where they're coming from. Right? So, essentially, empathy is just a conglomeration of these four factors. Okay. So, in practicing effective empathy, we need to be able to recognize our own bias. Do you have something to say?
What if, like, I don't really understand their, like, feelings because I've never, like, don't know anything that they're talking about, like anything that they're feeling.
So you might not understand their situation, but there's a pretty high likelihood that you're going to understand the emotion that they've attached to the situation.
Right.
Right?
Yeah.
Can you say that you felt almost every feeling in the spectrum of feelings?
No.
No? What do you feel like you haven't experienced yet?
Do you mean like when we talk about like foster care and the system and stuff like that?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's more situational. But you may still feel sorrow or joy.
Yeah.
Right? So those are still feelings that are attached to the situation. Just because you don't understand the situation doesn't mean you can't still understand that emotion.
I see.
Okay? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Cool.
You're supposed to give me a pink one.
We can trade them out at the end if you want to trade them.
But I've already ate all of them.
So, we'll dive back into the tips for practicing effective empathy. So, number one is to recognize your own bias. So, bias is basically the things that you favor. So, people who are angry or in a bad mood notice another person's bad mood more readily than another person's good mood. So you might be in a bad mood, and so you're only going to pick up on those bad mood vibes, right? If you're in a bad mood, like everything's kind of like a gray cloud. So you're going to feel that sullen, sunken, like I'm not feeling good today, right? So you might not pick up on another person's like happiness, you know, or it might make you more agitated. Who knows? So you can put aside your own feelings. When you have your own emotional agenda, it interferes with your ability to empathize with other people's feelings. Like I was just saying, if you're in a bad mood and you're like stuck on that bad mood, that's going to interfere with your ability to pick up on those emotions that other people are feeling too. So that's just something to be aware of. So you can be attentive to cues. So just tell people what you notice and ask for confirmation of what you're sensing. So,
what's emotional agenda?
An emotional agenda is basically your feelings in that moment. You're like, I'm mad today. Today, I'm in a bad mood. And that's generally what that is. You're welcome. Yeah, so I'll never assume that someone is feeling a certain way, right? So you can ask and make sure that someone's feeling the feelings that you are picking up on, okay? You can move to the next one. All right. So this is why I handed out this piece of paper. We're just going to take a couple of seconds to self-reflect. So I'm going to stop talking at you for a little bit, okay? And go ahead and answer these two however you'd like. So to what degree are you able to recognize someone else's emotional state? So that's just kind of a self-reflection. How good are you at doing this? Is there any way you can improve? Also, would you want someone else to be receptive to your emotional state if you're having a difficult day or are feeling strong emotions? So just go ahead and explain that. If you have questions, raise your hand and I'll come around to you, okay?
Is it like how you can tell that someone's in an emotional state? Or like, what does that mean? Like, to what degree?
Yeah, so can you tell, like, if I'm in a bad mood?
Okay.
Or a good mood. Either way. Does anyone have any questions?
Can we just answer this one, get this one?
Well, can I slide this on your lap? Do the book comes back?
Hold on.
Because book has to adjust it.
Just go to the bathroom.
I think the way they find out someone is
bad news. So good.
If you find out a person is mad, sad, or just downright confused, you can always tell by the facial expression. It's either you have pointed eyebrows or sad jawline. Or your eyes just start to water up. That's how you can figure out how other people are having a bad mood.
I'm glad that you're able to pick up on those cues, Chaz, because sometimes people don't look for the facial expression in others. Also, something else to keep in mind is tone of voice and someone's body language, right?
That's what I said.
Yeah.
I put body language, the way their mood changes in their voice.
So Kirvin wants me to read his.
Hello.
No? You just want me to read it?
Mm-hmm. Read the title.
Kirvin, a.k.a. the coolest kid. Thanks for your contribution.
Hey, what is it?
Did anyone else have anything written that they want to share? Mariah.
For the second one, I just said yes and no because it would really matter who the person is.
So you're more picky about who you want approaching you.
Yeah.
Yeah, not just like anyone off the street that comes up and says, "Hey, how are you? Are you
it has to be someone that I'm like near all the time."
Right. I agree with that myself too. I don't like it when strangers come up to me. Kind of like stranger danger, right?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Fine.
Did you have something, JJ?
Yeah. So I think I'm pretty good at recognizing people are mad, but my wife doesn't seem to think so. You know, because sometimes she want me to talk to her. At other times, she want to be left alone. So it's like weird sometimes not knowing the person or the situation. Because like me, I like being left alone when I'm angry. I don't like people coming up to me.
Right. So you need that time to kind of decompress before someone comes and talks to you. Nice snack. All right, are we good here? Okay.
So I just wanted to add that I think what he said was a really good statement, but I think I can relate to myself that I prefer to talk to someone almost immediately and try to get it worked out in the open so those emotions don't stew inside me.
Right. So basically what I'm hearing from everyone is everyone kind of has, you know, different preferences and how they want to have other people approach them to help them deal with their issues, right? Is that what I'm hearing?
I'm more, as you guys can tell, I'm more of a everyone leave me the hell alone kind of person when I'm in the moment. I mean, I don't care if you're Jesus Christ, I'll still cuss you out if I'm mad. I don't know. It's just something for me. I can't talk when I'm mad. It just works me up more for some reason. Talking about it when I'm mad works me up more.
So kind of you're similar to TJ. You need that time to decompress before you can talk things through.
Yeah.
All right, next slide. So, brief activity. So I have these nifty post-it notes in my pocket.
Oh, dang.
So, empathy mapping can be a powerful tool to build deeper understanding of how our world, words, and actions connect to our thoughts and feelings. Empathy maps are divided into four sections. So think, feel, say, and do. For an example, when I feel nervous, I might think I'm making mistakes. When I feel this way, I apologize a lot, so I say, and often take a deep breath. I do. So we're going to make an empathy map for our classroom. Okay? Next slide.
It sounds like fun.
It is going to be fun. Oh, thank you. So I'm going to hand all of you out four post-it notes. And on these post-it notes, you'll write down one emotion that you sometimes feel, a thought you connect to that emotion, an action you take when you have that feeling, and something you might say. Okay? So go ahead and raise your hand when you're done. So sometimes she feels anger. And that makes her want to do something like fight. And then as for saying, she'll raise her voice and curse at people until she's calm. Did you have a thought one, Natasha?
I didn't have enough sticky notes. But
what's something you do? I'll write it. Or think.
I want to be left alone.
I want to be left alone. So can anyone else relate to what Natasha's put up on the board?
Yes.
Yeah? Awesome. So Mariah used happy as her feeling. She'll say something like, "I love your smile." Which is which?
Sunny and be nice.
That's what you do.
Do
do is being nice, and then she'll think sunny thoughts. I like that. So do you, like, think of a specific color, or what do you think about when you're feeling happy? A sunny day? I like that.
Curvin,
okay. Curvin. Sometimes feels blah. He doesn't really think about anything when he feels blah, though. Just kind of blank, yeah? Mm-hmm. But it looks like you resort to playing basketball. So you play basketball when you feel blah.
Yeah?
Yeah? And then you just say, ball is life. So it sounds like basketball is like a coping mechanism for you. Yeah?
Well, what I do is play basketball.
Yeah, exactly. You play basketball.
Oh.
So does anyone else have any relation to what Curvin does when he's feeling blah? Yeah, Mariah? In what way? So does everyone get the concept of the emotional mapping?
Yeah.
Yeah? Okay. Next slide. So, what did you notice? Were there more similarities or differences in your answers? Like, do you feel like you could all relate to what people put onto the map? Yeah? Cool. So how can we use empathy in this classroom?
You can just try to understand each other better, I think.
Mm-hmm. In what way?
Like, don't piss each other off.
So, give people space when they're asking for space?
Or just don't do stupid stuff to make people mad.
Okay. But how about empathy? So if someone's having a bad day, or if they're having a good day,
I don't know.
You don't know? Alana? Is it related to the presentation? Okay, can you wait just a minute, Alana? Thank you. So if no one else has any other questions, this will kind of be an ongoing question in our classroom is how can we use empathy here? Okay? So always try and think about that and try and keep that ball rolling. So keep empathy in the forefront of your mind as we move forward in class, okay? So are there... Sounds good. Are there any other questions you have or any additional information that you wish I would have included?
Is it over?
I'm done.
No.
So is that all?
All
right. Yeah? Yeah, okay. Well, thank you all for having me.
Mariah's cheese and French.
Did you enjoy the presentation, guys?
Yes, you are an amazing teacher.
Woo!